The messaging and scheduled task utility is a versatile tool used to automate server-side tasks in the background. These tasks can include, but are not limited to, scheduling applications such as summaries or reports to run on a regular basis. You can then email these reports to a dynamic list of users on a daily, a weekly, a monthly, or any incremental basis you choose. You can save report outputs such as Excel, CSV, PDF as an actual physical file on the Empower server. You have the ability to automate an upload of data from a spreadsheet to your database on a scheduled basis. You can trigger automatic emails or any additional tasks to be ran or executed after a record has been added or updated from a maintainer web form. You can even do SMS text messaging with this utility. So this newly upgraded utility is a powerful instrument that adds an easier to use development interface and offers improved business efficiency for end users. To access the messaging and scheduled task utility, you will first go into the admin menu, and then under utilities, and then finally the messaging and scheduled task button. This brings us to our messaging and scheduled task utility main menu. Now, if this is the very first time you're coming into this utility, you're going to want to first make sure that you have set up your configuration to use the messaging utility. You'll do this under the messaging menu dropdown, and then task and message configuration. Now, I will not be going into the details of the configuration setup. We have a separate video that outlines what you will need for that. This video is titled Configuring the Messaging and Scheduled Tasks Utility. You can find this in our documentation, as well as I will include a link in the notes section below this YouTube video. Now, I will mention that the one thing that is required within this configuration property is the Empower server field. Now, this is going to be required even if you're not using messaging or emails. In order to run any task, you will need this property set. So you will set it as localhost to run from your server, and then the port that the installation is involved in. This takes us back to the main menu here. Now, there are currently no task groups within this dictionary. So if I create a new task, it takes us to the new task description field here. Within here, we can choose a task group. Now, tasks are going to be your individual jobs that are going to be executing your applications or your task. Now, tasks must live inside of a task group. You can have multiple tasks within a task group, and it's the actual group that is executed and called, not the individual tasks. So within here, you can choose to add your task to an existing task group. Currently, I have none available here, so I'm going to create a new task group. And then you can name your individual task as well. Now, the sequence number is not required, but if you want to prioritize or order your tasks within your task group, you can do so here. For example, if you have a report that needs to be ran after a summary runs, you would have a task group with at least two tasks in it. The task one would be the summary to be ran, and then the task two, sequence number two, would be the report to be ran. And then when the summary finishes, you would then execute, it would automatically execute the report to be ran. Now, again, it's not required, so I'll leave it zero for now. The other option that's available to us here is the message type selection. We'd have a predefined list of these message types that fulfill different purposes depending on what kind of task or job you need to execute. Each of these message types will have a brief description for that particular message, as well as a link to some documentation about that message type. The other last thing I want to mention in this page is that we've redesigned the Outlook here so that it's much like the application building process, where it's a very linear process where you need to create your message type and select your message, and then any available tabs or information along with that that correspond with that particular message type, you would then go through with that. So when I move to my next step here, I save and proceed to next step. It brings us to our target application. Now, depending on the message type that you've selected, you're going to have different options available to you based off of the message type that you chose. I've selected the report, so I'm going to choose my report that I want to actually have this task call. Then any additional parameters I can send to this would be used in this target application. So if I want to only include the grand total line in my report, then I can specify that just like I would through the URL, and it would pass that additional parameters to the URL. The next option down here is the map fields to report. This is only going to be used if you are calling your task from a maintainer, because what can happen is that you can pass field values from your maintainer to your target application. Here, as a report, we can pass the field values to a record selections. For example, if you have maybe a shopping cart application, and your maintainer form, after they submit that form, you want to email them a confirmation email or some kind of invoice. So what you want to do is you want to pass through the order number that they've selected, that they've generated from the maintainer, to your report. You can come in here and you can pass through, maybe CusNo is the value we want to pass through to my report for the first record selection, and then order number is the field name for the second record selection. So I can pass those values through, and the report will filter based off of the values from my maintainer. The next option down is going to be whether you want to send this report as an attachment in an email or embedded in the body of the message. If you choose to send it as an attachment, you can choose the output format here. And then also, if you're choosing it as an attachment, you need to specify the file name that you will be including in the email. Now, very important with your file name is that you do need to include the extension, the file extension for that output format that you have selected. And additionally, with the file name, is that you can also pass through values to the file name as you've selected. So I want to include the invoice number or the order number. So I am passing through the order number to my record selection number 2 of my report, which means I can include that in my file name of my report as well. Now, additionally, we have logic in place that you can also include the date or timestamp that that report was ran by just including the dollar sign curly bracket timestamp or date stamp. Once you've selected all of your options for your target application type, you can again move forward to the next tab by clicking the save and proceed to next step. The recipients tab is going to allow you to dictate where your application will be sent to. Since I will be emailing a report, my first option for recipients per message, the first selection for send one report for all recipients means that the target application, which is my report, will be ran once and then sent to all of the recipients that I have selected. The next option to send one report per recipient means that the target application, again my report, will be ran separately for all of the recipients and then emailed out individually. And then the last option, send one report to address from your web form, means that if you, again, you are calling or triggering this task from a maintainer, you can map an email address field from your web form to the your task group here. So under email address, if I maybe have an email field in my maintainer, I can map that and let the task group know that's the email that I want to send this report to. Skipping over this next option very quickly, I'm going to move down to the additional addresses list. This is where you can hard code the list of addresses that you would like to send to, and you can separate them out with a comma. Now, this is your hard coded list of addresses. If you want to dynamically set which recipients will receive this report or your target application, you can call a distribution list with this option here. Now, a distribution list is a separately maintained list of addresses that you can set up and you can call. So I'm going to select a distribution list that I've created. Now, what you can also do is, depending on your list, maybe you have something in here that you would like to filter your distribution list to only receive those particular or only to send your task to those recipients. So maybe you have a department in your master distribution list and you only want to send out this task or this report to your admin positions. So you can come in here, you can specify to only filter out records with admin as the department, and only they will receive that application or this task. Now once you select to use and distribution list, you have two new options in here as well. You can set up your distribution list to filter your distribution list based off of any fields from your maintainer. So again, you can map your fields from your maintainer to your distribution list to filter that distribution list. So if we kind of, if we use that same example of a shopping cart, and if I have my ID, my user ID in the shopping cart maintainer application, and I want to map that to the ID of the record of my distribution list, I can pass that through here and it will filter that distribution list to only pull in that record, so it knows exactly who to send that email out to. The next option is to filter the report or the target application using the distribution list. So in a different example, if you send one report per recipient, maybe we want to filter the report based off of the customer number from the distribution list. So again, using the example of sending one report per recipient, choosing this way is going to filter the report based off of customer number, and each customer will receive a separate email pertaining to just their customer number. Now, once you've selected the recipients here, again, we're going to move forward to the email info. The email info tab is where you can include the details for your email message. The first field here is sender. If left blank, this is going to pull from the sender field from your configuration file. You do have the option of overwriting this, the from address for your email message. The message subject is where you can include the message subject line for your email. So you can pass through any variables or any parameters that you're including in your target application as well, such as I'm passing through an order number, so I can pass through the order number variable, and it will replace that with the actual value when this task is ran. The message is going to be included here where the body of the email is where you can dictate what you would like to show there. Then lastly, we have an attachments field where you can include any kind of static files that you would like to include in your email message. Now these will be pulling from the job streams attachments folder directly on the Empower server. So if you have any kind of terms and conditions PDF or any kind of licensing PDF or any other kind of physical file that you want to include in an email message, you can specify those here with the file names and then separate them out with a comma. Moving forward to the last tab is the review tab here, where it is an overview of all of these selections and options that you have made for your task group. Then lastly, once you return to the main menu screen here, we have a brief overview of the task that we have just created. If you had multiple tasks here, it would list them in the order and under the sequence that you have specified in your building process as well. Now, I'm not going to execute this task group here. There are a few different ways to execute your task groups, and we do cover those in a separate video titled Executing Task Groups. You can find this on our online documentation as well as a link in the notes section below in the YouTube video. So that wraps up the utility here. Thanks for watching and have a great one.